Hello, and thanks for joining us for this service on the fourth Sunday of Advent, just a few days before Christmas. We're meeting live today in Little Sutton Church. And whether you're joining us on video, listening on audio, or whether you're one of the ones to whom we've distributed this service on paper to read alone, we pray that God will be with you and will bless you. Let's listen first of all as the Reverend Jackie Belfield leads us in our liturgy for lighting the fourth candle of Advent.
We light the first three candles and we pause. O God, we light the fourth candle of Advent hope. We hear your angel Gabriel and witness the faith of Mary. Fill us with your grace and light. We recall the times we have struggled but said yes. We know times when God has filled us and our world with blessing. And we give you thanks, God, when you have provided peace, hope and light. Mary was a young, strong, spiritual woman. Even though her life was not easy, she heard God's voice and said yes. Her song was a prayer that would uplift those who were downtrodden. Her lyrics shattered the proud and called the world to change. She would bear within her the promised child, Jesus, the light of the world. This Advent, we respond to God's beckoning to us as well. Revealing God, visit us and fill us with your Spirit. Bring your good news to life within us. Give us courage to carry your light into the injustices and shadows of this world. Amen.
Light a candle in the darkness. Light a candle in the night. Let the love of Jesus light us. Light a candle in the night. Like a flicker in the darkness comes a mother's desperate cry. Then a baby's voice in answer brings the coming of the light. Light a candle in the darkness. Light a candle. Let the love of Jesus light us. Light a candle in the night. It did not come in wealth and grandeur. It did not stand with those of power. He had no status to commend him. He was homeless, he was poor. Light a candle in the darkness. Light a candle in the night. Let the love of Jesus light us. Light a candle in the night. but he came to heal the wounded, and he came to heal the scars of a world that's bruised and broken, where the image has been marred. Light a candle in the darkness. Light a candle in the night. Let the love of Jesus light us. Light a candle in the night. Light a candle in the darkness. Light a candle in the night. Let the love of Jesus light us. Light a candle in the night. Light a candle in the night.
Let's pray. God of hope, who brought love into this world, be the love that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought peace into this world, be the peace that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought joy into this world, be the joy that dwells between us. God of hope, the rock we stand upon, be the centre, the focus of our lives, always and especially at this Advent time. Amen. Let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let's listen to the great hymn, the Charles Wesley hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy. To thy glorious throne.
the second book of Samuel, chapter 7, verses 1 to 11. God's promise to David. After the king was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am, living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." But that night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, and appointed you ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men on earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own, and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people shall not oppress them any more, as they did at the beginning, and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you."
Thank you to Alan White for that reading. As we'll see later on, this promise to David was one of very many promises and preparations for the birth of the Messiah. Let's listen to the great carol from the 20th century. "Long ago, prophets knew Christ would come."
The Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. The birth of Jesus foretold. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
The story of the Annunciation, Gabriel's visit to Mary and announcing that she would bear the child Jesus, is one of the great themes in classical painting. There are literally hundreds of paintings. Here's just one. It's by Filippo Lippi. I'm not going to say too much about it because it's the basis of our Advent video reflection, which you'll be able to see tomorrow on Facebook and on the Wirral Methodist YouTube channel. But just to say that here we have the announcement to Mary, and at the same time we see the Holy Spirit descending on a beam of light from God the Father in heaven to Mary, if you like, the moment of conception. We don't know exactly how that all happened, and we don't need to know. But there's certainly a truth that as Mary submitted to the word of God and submitted to the challenge that had been given her, and as she said, "Be it unto me according to your word," that was the point at which, in some way, the birth of Jesus was conceived in her heart. Actually, that's not so unusual for ourselves, because for those of us who are Christians, we know that that moment when we say, "Lord, we hear your word and we receive it into our hearts," that's the point at which new birth, in some mysterious way, takes place in our hearts. The Christmas story is the story of the incarnation of Christ. C.S. Lewis calls this the central miracle asserted by Christians. He says this: "Every other miracle prepares for this, exhibits this, or results from this." The great 20th century theologian J.I. Packer says this: "The supreme mystery with which the gospel confronts us lies in the Christmas message of incarnation." We rightly focus on the sufferings and death and resurrection of Christ as being at the heart of our faith, but it was the incarnation that is the greater mystery. Let's look at how the gospel accounts of the coming of Christ help us to reflect on this amazing truth that God became man, that humanity and divinity met in the womb of Mary, that the Word became flesh. That expression, the word became flesh, of course, comes from John chapter 1. He uses the word logos. In the beginning was the logos, and the logos was with God, and the logos was God. That was a word very familiar to Greeks. The philosophers had coined it many centuries before to refer to the motive force in the universe, the divine reason implicit in the cosmos, in the creation. They had discerned that there was something behind what we could see, and John was declaring it to them. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. Now, you could go right through the New Testament looking for example after example of how this is emphasized by Paul and by all the other writers. Just think of the way he writes in the Philippians as well. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, although he was equal with God, emptied himself and came down amongst us and was made as a servant. But let's just look at something that Jesus said, which is interesting. On one occasion, a group of the rabbis, a group of Pharisees, were challenging him and were rejecting what he was saying by proudly stating, "We are sons of Abraham," as if that was the clincher. They had the generations behind them. But Jesus simply replies, "Verily I say to you, truly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." Now, he was not simply saying that he was more ancient than Abraham, which would have been startling in itself. He chose his words very carefully. Remember when Moses met with God at the burning bush and received his commission to go to Egypt to bring out the children of Israel? He said, "Who shall I say sent me?" And God simply replied, "I am who I am. Tell them I am sent you." So here's Jesus saying, before Abraham was, I am. The Pharisees who heard him perfectly understood what he was claiming. And immediately it says they took up stones to stone him to death. Interestingly, you get something similar at the end of the gospel story when Jesus is confronted in the Garden of Gethsemane. They say, "Who are you seeking?" And they reply, "We're seeking Jesus of Nazareth." And Jesus says, "I am he." Or in the original, he just says, "I am." And it says they fell back, and he had to encourage them to come and to arrest him. So the Word was eternal. The Word was God. And Jesus of Nazareth, born of Mary, was the eternal Word of God, the I Am. And then John tells us that the Word was made flesh. The Word became human. This is where the amount of space given to the genealogies at the beginning of Matthew and Luke starts to make sense. Matthew, of course, wanted to establish that Jesus was born as part of Israel in the line of descendants of David, hence the reading we had earlier from Samuel. He takes a story back from Abraham, and he says Abraham was the father of, and it's all the father of, the father of, the father of. Luke does something slightly different. He starts at the other end and he says Jesus was, as was supposed, the son of Joseph. So he takes the genealogy through Joseph, through the male line, as you do. But he says the son of, the son of, the son of. But you'll find that he doesn't go back to Abraham. He goes all the way back to Adam. He locates Jesus not just as part of Israel, but as part of the whole lineage of humanity. You could say that from the very birth of Adam, the line of humanity was being prepared for the reception into it of Jesus, the Son of God, Christ is rooted in the nation of Israel, but he's also rooted in humankind. His lineage goes back to the creation. Jesus was born of woman in a normal way. His conception, of course, was not normal, but his growth in the womb, his birth, was all normal. He grew as a child. He had no magical powers when he was young. You get all sorts of strange stories in some of the early pseudo-gospels which talk about him exercising magical powers as a child. But you don't get any of that in the truth, in the gospel. He grew up a normal child. He had normal human limitations. He had to learn. He obviously knew his Old Testament and he was able to quote it, but that wasn't something that was just instilled in him. He no doubt had to learn it, the way we all do. He was truly human. In the Gospels we see that he is tired. We see that he's overcome by emotion. He stands before Lazarus's grave and he weeps. He was tempted. He was hungry. He ate, he drank, he slept. He was truly human. And finally, of course, to put the final seal on that, he suffered and he died a truly human death. Now, how can we reconcile these two truths? He was human, he was divine. The early church was faced with challenges on both fronts. Some denied that Jesus was really human. They imagined him as, in some sense, taking on the image of humanity without having a truly human nature. Actually, in one of the carols we sing, "Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see," which, if you wanted to be awkward, you could understand it with that kind of sense that he wasn't truly human, he was just veiled in humanity. But of course it goes on to say, "Hail the incarnate deity," so I'm sure the hymn writer wasn't getting it wrong. But more often people struggled with his true divinity. There was a lengthy heresy, a lengthy school of thought which went on for centuries, which was based around the idea that Jesus was born a normal human, but that at some point in his life, usually regarded as being his baptism, he was somehow given divinity, he was somehow taken on by God. And by the middle of the 4th century, these controversies were so rampant that the early church sat down and said, you know, we need to settle this. And these controversies eventually resulted in the creeds, which in many churches are recited week by week. So, for example, the Council of Nicaea was called in 325 AD to address the false doctrines which were running wild in some parts of the church. And they agreed on what we call the Nicene Creed, which is still used today. Here's what it says. "We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, begotten of the Father, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down and was incarnate and was made man." I used to struggle a bit over that expression, begotten, not made, because it still sounds as if first there was God, and then somehow he gave birth to the second member of the Trinity, the Lord Jesus Christ. But the best understanding of it, or the more accurate understanding of it, is to conflate the words "only begotten" and make them "only begotten." It's kind of using a word which says he's the one and only, that's probably more what we'd say, the one and only Son of God, equal in the Trinity with the Holy Spirit. So the council declared Jesus Christ was both God and man. We can't really conceive of this. To use a really silly example, I don't know if you go out and see all the dog walkers everywhere, and you'll chat to someone and you'll say, "What kind of dog's this?" Because it maybe looks a bit strange. They'll say, "Oh, it's a Labradoodle." And you go, okay, it's half Labrador and half poodle. And you look at it and it kind of looks a bit like a Labrador and it kind of looks a bit like a poodle, but it doesn't really look like either of them. It's neither one thing nor the other. You can get ligers as well, apparently, when you cross a lion with a tiger. It looks a bit like a lion, looks a bit like a tiger, but it's really not either or. That's not what Jesus, being divine and human, is in any sense like. He's not a bit divine and a bit human, some kind of awkward mix of the two. He is completely divine, completely human. To carry on with that silly analogy, it's as if you looked at the dog and it was absolutely a poodle. Then you looked away and looked again and you go, well, no, it's absolutely a Labrador. It's 100% both. The two natures of Jesus don't spill over into each other. His humanity wasn't somehow made easier to bear because he was divine. He didn't have those magic superhero powers. And his divinity is not weakened by the fact that he is human. His sufferings were as a man and not somehow alleviated because he was God. And his heavenly reign exhibits the wisdom and certainty of God, not the weaknesses of a human. So it really is all about the incarnation. Every aspect of the nativity stories is there to reinforce this understanding. The shepherds, emphasizing the ordinary humanness of Jesus, yet confronted by angels announcing the birth of the Son of God. The wise men speaking of his status as the ultimate king and priest. The genealogies rooting him not just in Israel, but in humanity itself, right back to Adam. And here, in our passage for today, the angel tells Mary all she or we need to know. You will name him Jesus, which of course means Saviour. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. This truth brings us great comfort. He is human, so he can fully empathize with our fears, our needs, and our temptations. Hebrews 4:15 says this, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin." And he is divine, so his help is sure and his patience inexhaustible. The human Jesus understands our needs. The divine Christ is able to meet them. C.S. Lewis puts it like this. In the Christian story, God descends to reascend. He comes down, down from the heights of absolute being into time and space, down into humanity, down to the very roots and seabed of the nature he has created. But he goes down to come up again and bring the ruined world up with him. This Christmas, may we know the love of Christ coming down to be close to us, and the power of Christ lifting us up to be close to him. Amen.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand. Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh Mary, did you know?
Loving God, as we approach the day of Christ's birth, help us to throw wide the doors of our hearts in preparation. Help us to sense the importance of what happened so long ago when Mary was visited by the angel Gabriel. To remember the words of the angels and the prophets and the teachers of old, and to celebrate all the promises you made through them. Help us to take firm hold of the meaning of all these things and to know in the depths of our being that even now you are seeking to work in us and through us to fulfil the promises you have made. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, may this Christmas season be for us and for those around us a season of healing. May it be a season of hope and of love and of joy. May it be a time of true sharing and rejoicing in all the earth. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray, O God, for those in need around us, for those who need a second birth, for those who need a tender touch and a healing word, for those who are isolated and lonely over this Christmas time. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray too, O God, for the children of our world and all those of tender faith, all those who have no home to call their home, all those who are hungry and thirsty. Bless, we pray, the innocent of the earth and all those who trust in you. Bless the humble and the powerless, and bring down from their thrones those who are full of pride and those who are indifferent. Lord, hear our prayer. Bless, we pray, each special one we name before you now. Lord, hear our prayer. We ask these things, O God, with hope and praise in our hearts, our minds and our souls, through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let's conclude by singing a carol. A well-known carol, O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie.
Oh,
blessing. May you take with you today the presence of Jesus through the Holy Spirit, and may the Father sustain you with his everlasting love during this Christmas season. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.